All right, welcome to It Could Be Voice, which is my program name for just about anything I want to put up. And I'm very happy to be interviewing a man who I've just met, but I feel like I know him. I feel like we've been on a long road trip together. Ron Franscell, Franscell, is it? I believe is
Franscell.
Franscell. Let's show you what he looks like. There he is. Ron, thanks for being here. Ron
Thank
is a
you for
terrific
having
writer.
Me.
He is a novelist. He has done, I believe, 19 books. Is that right?
That's right. That's right.
And
hard to believe.
Yeah. Anyway, I met him because I auditioned and had the honor of narrating a new novel of his called Death Row. It's funny, Ron, because I just finished another book that was written by a person named Jess Rowe.
Jess.
It's very, what are the odds? Very strange. Hello, Edward. And Death Row, which was really a lot of fun to read. It was I guess you'd call it a kind of a crime thriller. It was quite grisly, quite brutal, but also had a lot of humor and great characters. And of course, you know, for me as an actor, that was very attractive. I really enjoyed it. It was an easy book to read in that it scanned and flowed very well. The mark of good writing, I think, I've noticed, is that it is rather easy to read, and it flows easily. As an on-camera actor, I've noticed that, you know, badly written scripts are almost impossible to memorize. They're very difficult to communicate, and it's similar with audiobooks in that way. Anyway, welcome, Ron.
Thank you for having me, Jim. I appreciate it.
Yeah, so let's talk a little bit about Death Row, because it's sort of a hot topic right now, and it's your 19th book.
19th.
Can you tell us a little bit about how it all started, how you got interested in it?
Well, it's interesting because I've made my bones as a true crime writer. I'm a best-selling author in true crime.
Hmm.
With, you know, Edgar nominations and New York Times best-selling and you name it. Long comes COVID, and I suddenly can't go out and do the kinds of boots on the ground research that I do, talking to people and seeing the places and touching them, the things that are around. Can't get a hotel room, can't casually pump gas, can't jump on an airplane, can't get into courthouses or libraries, and talking to people, most of all, was a problem. So I holed up in my office with 40 years of journalism and true crime experience and knowledge and poured it into this fictional story. So that's where it comes from. It's I guess you could say, spawned by COVID. When we finally did sell it, the publisher wanted a sequel to it. So we'll do the sequel. I'm working on it right now. And, it's fun. I haven't retired from true crime, but this fiction writing, crime fiction, has been interesting. A different approach for storytelling for me.
Yeah, and you've been on the crime beat for quite a while.
I have.
And let's go back a little earlier too, because I noticed, I don't know a lot about you. I forgive me for not being really, really an expert. But you grew up in Wyoming, I understand.
I did.
And that's a big, big ass country, big sky, big.
It really is.
Space, spacious place.
Yeah, it's a different kind of place, as you have presented there. To the rest of the world, I think it represents the Wild West. It is the Wild West, even now. And they're proud of that. But that space that you're talking about, that sky, that emptiness,
yeah.
On one hand, it's beautiful. Anybody who's seen a picture of or been blessed enough to see in person the Tetons knows this majestic beauty that is Wyoming. On the flip side, though, is that that beauty has a dark side, and that emptiness, sort of endless space and sky, can aid and abet the bad guys.
How is that so? How is that more than in a more condensed city kind of atmosphere?
Well, because it gives the bad guy a place not only to hide his bad behavior, but it gives him a place to hide his bodies. There are places in Wyoming that no human foot has ever set down. If I could take you on a drive across Wyoming, my home state, or Montana, I think you'd be in awe of that beauty, but pretty soon you'd be thinking, you know, if I ever wanted to lose something forever, this would be a great place.
I get it. Yeah, it's almost like there are different kinds of barriers I was reading about. And obviously you have walls and you have those kind of prison is a kind of a barrier, but too much space is also another barrier. If you're without a car and you have to get 30 miles and you don't want to run out of water, that's a big barrier too.
Well, it absolutely is. And every place has its own unique characteristics, particularly in crime. But out there, it's that space and that ability to do just about anything with few witnesses and a fairly high expectation that it's not going to be easily discovered. Mm-hmm. My last book, A True Crime, just came out in March of last year, is called Shadow Man. And it's about a case in Montana in 1973, the disappearance of a little girl, a tourist girl, camping in a state campground in Montana. And she disappears literally into thin air. There's not a clue. There's not a suspect. There's not a shred of evidence. The FBI agent in charge is so frustrated for months that he's grasping at straws, and it causes the FBI to issue its first ever criminal profile, which up to that point had been poo-pooed as black magic. And the J. Edgar Hoover himself thought it was hokum. It was the emptiness of Montana. It was the space they were dealing with, the lack of population, a sparseness of all kinds that really contributed to that frustration. And so the FBI creates their first ever profile. And now, 50 years later, there's hardly a crime drama on TV that doesn't employ a profiler in some way. But back then, it was generally disregarded. Police and law enforcement in general didn't like the idea. And to this day, law enforcement has some significant difficulties with profiling. But that's a whole other book.
Interesting. And that was a true crime.
That was a true story. Yes.
True story. Do you know a lot of people in the FBI? Do you have like people that you've talked to?
And I do now. Fortunately, before that, I didn't have a big need to know them. But in the case of Shadow Man, my research required me to get the FBI's case file on that abduction and ultimately murder, and ultimately what turned into a serial killing. In order to get at that information, I had to ask for the FBI's case file on it. And so somewhere over here in the office, I have some 13,000 documents sitting on a CD. And that was their gift to me, and took a few months to digest it.
I'll bet. Hey, I see you've got some books in the background there. I assume a lot of those are yours. And how does it feel, that first book that you write, when you see it and you hold it in your hand as an actual physical book?
Oh, man. It's indescribable. When I was young and I wrote my first book, the goal was to write a book. It wasn't to publish a book. It was to just see if I had it in me to finish a damn thing. It was a novel. It was a literary novel. It was about two brothers kind of engaged in a very necessary relationship. And both impacted by the wounds of the Vietnam War. Took place in Wyoming because that was where I was from, and that's the place that I understood. But I also felt like the some of our national character wells up from small towns and overlooked places. So I wrote this book, and after some struggles about it, I finally finished it. At that point, I began thinking, okay, well, I did my goal, but what if we try now to publish it? Ultimately, we did get it published, and it went on to some considerable acclaim. The San Francisco Chronicle listed it among its 100 best novels of the 20th century West.
Wow.
Nobody was more surprised than I was about that.
Now, what was the road to publishing it? Because once you've got a swell manuscript sitting there in your desk, I understand it's a little bit of a gnarly path to get there.
That one was really gnarly. Here's this, unknown guy from Wyoming, which is kind of an unknown space to begin with, an alien country. And I started looking for an agent, and I actually got an agent fairly quickly. Which was encouraging. Because
how did you do that, if I can ask?
Well, it was the usual, you query agents and say, hey, I've got this book, would you like to represent it? And I probably was turned down a few times, but I got an agent fairly quickly, which was surprising to me.
Did you send them the whole book or just a couple of chapters?
I think it started with sample chapters, and then, and if they liked that, they would say, send more. The problem was, I was very encouraged by getting an agent so quickly. Getting a publisher was going to prove to be a difficult thing. We circulated that manuscript for about 18 months. It was getting these glowing rejections. We love your characters. We love your story. We love your writing, whatever it is they love. But no, it's not for us. Literary novel by an unknown male writer tends to be a difficult sell.
Was it a crime literary novel?
No, it wasn't. It was just about these two brothers' relationships.
Okay.
And a relationship in this little town and what one meant to the other. It was a special story to me in that it dealt with Vietnam and the path to publishing was, as you said, gnarly. Like 18 months circulating, we got 37 rejections. I think we had submitted it to 38. 37 rejections. The agent said, hey, listen, why don't you go back, do something a little more commercial, a mystery or a romance or something somebody will buy and read. I thought, okay, I'll do that. And so we were about to stick this manuscript in the drawer for my kids to find when I die. When that 38th house, a little dinky, feisty startup house in Alabama, calls and says, We loved this book.
I'll tell you what, we loved the book. We read it out loud. Everybody loved it.
And they bought it. And the next thing I know, one of the big houses, Berkeley, picked up the reprint rights. And and it took off. It became a USA Today bestseller. It got the San Francisco Chronicle's beautiful listing. And I thought that's what I was going to do for the rest of my writing career, is maybe write nice little literary novels. But I'm a senior writer at the Denver Post covering the American West and writing these stories where about the idea of where the past, the present, and the future intersect in the West. And I was doing it in this narrative style because I had written a couple of novels by that time. Then 9/11 comes along and the Post sent me overseas to the Middle East to cover the beginnings of the terror war. Right after 9/11, the day that planes are allowed to fly again, a photographer and I are flying to the Middle East.
Wow. Where in the Middle East?
Everywhere in the Middle East. My job was to get into as many Arab and Muslim capitals and countries as I could. We were embedded with a few American units in different places. We were aboard the USS Enterprise for a few weeks, I think. We were in the Sahara with the preparations for the ground invasion of Afghanistan that never happened. And we were with a special forces unit in Pakistan. But mostly we were just landing in Arab and Muslim capitals and doing reporting and then moving on. And I think we got everywhere except Iran. We got into Iran, but quickly got kicked out of Iran.
Well, it just seems like it's interesting to me that obviously things led you on this path, but you know, as a writer, a senior writer for the Denver Post, it doesn't seem like that automatically someone who's writing nice literary pieces about brothers suddenly gets shipped off to the Middle East after.
Yeah. Well, and that was because I, you know, was a senior reporter and because they wanted me to get in and do some of that narrative reporting that I was doing here. The result of that though, was by the time we were flying home, we were dead tired. We were, in a lot of ways, cynical and sick of this and of what we've been seeing and reporting on. I happened to pick up a French news magazine on the plane and was leafing through it and saw a picture of two people leaping from the World Trade Center holding hands. Mm. We had left the United States so quickly after 9/11. I'd never seen that. I hadn't seen a lot of the American reporting on 9/11 to that point. That moment just sent me back in a nanosecond to my childhood in Wyoming, where the two girls, the two girls next door are abducted, terrorized through the night. There's a rape. Then they're both thrown off a very, very high bridge into a very deep, dark canyon. One dies and the other survives miraculously.
Oh, my God.
That affected my town overnight. And there in the dark in that airplane coming home from the Middle East, to me, it felt like exactly what had happened here with 9/11, that... Mm. That we went to bed on one night in September 1973, a kid. I'm just a little kid. And by the time we go to bed the next night, it's a completely different place. Everything has changed.
Right.
And to this day, it's the same. It's never went back. So that book, called The Darkest Night, was my first true crime. Even though I didn't really write it as a true crime, it was true, and it was about a crime. And it was very intimate because I'm involved as a in the first rank of kids around these victims.
Did you write it from the point of view of someone who was there? Like, this happened to me, I saw this. And
no, not from their point of view. It was more in that narrative style, telling the story. But I pop up in that story a couple of times. Not originally. I didn't originally pop up in it in the first draft. The publisher just told me I needed to be in it because of my role, as just one of the kids who was around, and B, as a journalist who's now telling the story.
Yeah. You walk past the mirror in the show.
Yeah, exactly. And it was, it became such a success, it became an international bestseller, New York Times bestseller. So significant that suddenly something happened that you understand very well. I was typecast. my writing and my market and my sensibility and my kind of story was true crime stories. My agent, my editors really weren't interested in anything else I would do. So from that point, book number 4 to book number 18, with only one exception, have all been true crime oriented. And that one exception was sort of proved the rule. When I wrote it, it was a road trip memoir with my son.
Oh, yeah.
And my agents and editors all said, hey, good luck with it, but we're not going to be part of that. So it's interesting now, coming to what brings us together, Def Row, that I've again disrupted that flow of true crime. And it remains to be seen whether both my market, my fans, if you will follow me because they like the way I tell a story, or whether I'll have to develop a whole new kind of market. I don't know. We'll see.
We'll see. Well, this is a nice segue. A little while ago, Lockie Battersby asked, can you read a page from the book? And I you can step right out of the scene. I'll step right in, and I'm going to read. This is actually what I auditioned with. I found that, and I will read that now. This is from Def Row by Ron Franscell. I'll learn to say it eventually. And it takes place in this wonderful cafe. This is an early scene. The old men of Def Row were already jousting when Bell came in a little before 8 that morning. After clomping the skiff of snow from his boots on the You Are Here welcome mat outside the front door. As of today, Cotton Minahan announced to everyone, I haven't had any booze for 30 days. A couple of the guys raised their coffee mugs in tribute, though none of them truly believed that Minahan, a notorious fan of wild turkey, had gone on the wagon. Really? Squeaked Coogan, the skeptical old newspaper man who barely tolerated Minahan anyway. A whole 30 days. Minahan rolled his eyes. Well, hell, he said, exasperated. Not all in a row. The whole table groaned, even Father Bert. He saw no sin in drinking. He was fond of saying that whenever four priests gather together, there shall be a fifth. But he worried about the old fire chief's pride in his excesses. And maybe his liver. Come on, Minahan pleaded. That was funny. Bell said nothing, just shook his head. He could see that the normally acerbic Ollie Furman, the newest candidate for the Flatiron County Commission, was choking back a caustic and likely hilarious comment. Hey, at least I can joke about my problem, Minahan continued, clearly miffed. You never hear Roxy joking about his solitaire addiction. That was too much for Ollie. Politics be damned. You want sympathy, Cotton? Well, you can find it in the dictionary somewhere between shit and syphilis. little section from Death Row. And shows us back and forth. There's a wonderful relationship, these five or so old men that hang out. And I think it's beautiful the way, I don't think this is tipping the hand too much or spoiling anything, that these terrific old characters who are, they're not really a Greek chorus, but they are sort of on the outskirts of the story, and they start to get more and more helpful to the protagonist and actually contribute to solving the crime and handling some of the chaos of what goes on in this town. Anyway,
well, every small town, man, I can't speak for Southern California really, but I think every small town has a bunch of old guys who gather together on most mornings to, you know, save the world and talk about Viagra and poke fun at each other and kind of remember their glory days, which are all behind them now. And they're becoming invisible. They're not important anymore. In Death Row, we have this retired Denver homicide detective who has gone to this small mountain town in Colorado to fade away. He doesn't want to have anything to do with any of these people. He just wants to live the rest of his life and lick whatever wounds he's carried along. Then he's kind of dragged in by Father Bert, his best friend, into an old crime against his better judgment, let's say it that way. He just doesn't want to be involved, but he gets involved. But he's not a cop anymore. And the local cops don't trust him. He doesn't have the forensic, doesn't have the science, doesn't have the team that a big city homicide detective would have. What he has are these six old guys. And, you know, you've got the retired newspaper editor, and you've got the retired doctor and the chemistry professor or teacher from the high school. The drummed out old fire chief Cotton Minahan, who lost his job for drunken fire truck racing, but this crew of old guys becomes his forensic team in a sense, not wittingly. It sort of happens by accident.
No, it happens very organically. It's beautiful.
It does. And so by the, you know, by the time this starts to get serious, he realizes he's got some guys here who might know something. And maybe their glory days aren't really that far behind them. So it's a classical mystery. It has a crime and an investigation. But it's also kind of a literary dive into the lives of these old guys, and I think it explores some of what it's like to be growing old, to be growing invisible, and want things to be different.
Yeah, I understand. Edward says, "Drunk fire truck racing. I want to see that in a film." I'm sure it would lend itself very well to a film, I think, or a limited series, Death Row.
I think it would. I think it would be a lot of fun. You know,
have you had has anyone ever approached you about any of your books?
Not yet. I mean, about any of them? Yes. Some of my books, my previous books. This one, not yet. Mm-hmm. But I do think that it'd be a great vehicle for a lot of the familiar faces in Hollywood who might be looking for work that really kind of touches on something they might be feeling themselves. I don't know.
Yeah, J.K. Simmons would be a great part for J.K. Simmons.
Oh, you know, the faces that pop up in my head for those old guys, you know. Steve Buscemi, you know, yeah. Paul Giamatti. There are a bunch of them, and we've been playing that little game. But I saw the comment there. Yeah. That's part of it. That's the way older men show their affection, at least in our time.
Yeah.
We can't walk up and throw our arms around a friend and kiss him on the cheek and say, I love you, man. We've got to say, it looks like you put on some weight since, you know, right. we poke and we prod, and it's a way we show affection. So their interaction has a lot. It comes out in a lot of that kind of, insulting sarcasm.
And then you have Father Mullen. And is he based on anybody that you know? Or
Father Bert Clancy?
Oh yeah, sorry.
Yes, not based on somebody, but I had help. I'm not Catholic. He's obviously a kind of unorthodox guy. He hunts, he fishes, mildly profane. He's rebellious. He's got a very strong moral center, and it keeps him from being silent. He expresses himself, and has, and that's why he was originally banished to this little parish in the mountains. He, like Bell, had served in Vietnam. He was a chaplain there. A battlefield chaplain. So they share that too.
Right.
Like I say, he's unorthodox in a way that we can love. And I hope people find him as lovable as I do. At one point I was talking about killing him. I was saying not killing him, but having him die.
Yeah.
Which happens to old guys. My wife, who had been following the development of that character for a long time, had fallen more in love with him, I think, than maybe even Woodrow Bell, the detective. And I've now had a couple of editors get back to me and name him as really one of their favorite characters in the whole book. So
yeah, good one for the next one. Good character for the next one. It's you got a nice little ensemble there, a nice little core of actors
I like being around them. It's one thing that I'm finding as I'm writing the sequel is that I kind of like these guys. Now my characters, you know, they don't talk to me. I mean, that would be a little schizoid if these voices in my head are telling me how it's going to go. But I like behaving and thinking on their behalf. They challenge me.
Very well.
Yeah. It's fun.
I understand that for my role as an impressionist, I understand that, you know, it's exactly the same thing. You can take, I think of it as taking other viewpoints knowingly. You know, that's what acting is. And it is, it sounds like that's what composing and creating scenes are for a writer, is that you
look
at it from his point of view, you know?
Right, yeah. Right. And now I have a lot of writer friends who say, oh, my characters talk to me.
Uh-huh.
But honestly, I back away a little bit when they start talking like that.
Yeah. One thing I don't know your trade. I don't understand it. I've written short things and
very good things too. I've read some of your stuff.
Oh, very kind. But I realized that a novel, like a screenplay, is this massive thing. And just practically speaking, like, you know, if I'm editing a video or something, I can look over, I spend a lot of time watching it from beginning to end. And, you know, usually they're 3-4 minutes long. And I can go, okay, well, I watch it three or four times. I make adjustments all the time. Pretty soon, wow, 45 minutes went by because I watched that same 3 minutes over and over again, 19 times or whatever. When you're working on a big novel, what do you do practically so that you don't have to say, well, from chapter one on, and I'll see if this all adds up? Do you outline things or do you map it out, or what do you technically do? Or do you read it from like, just go through and read 200-300 pages every now and then?
I early on in my book writing, I did more outlining until I kind of internalized it. It just became just an instinctive thing.
Mm-hmm.
I still will start my day with a little note to myself that I put on top of my computer screen, and it tells me what I need to achieve that day. Mm. And it's something small, it's something digestible.
Mm.
You know, I if you start thinking of this project as 95 or 100,000 words, and every day is, oh my God, I've only got 94,000, you know, 412 more to go. That wears on you. So I think what you do is you digest it into something manageable, and write one scene today. Mm. I need to get my guy from his house to the crime scene where he doesn't know he's going and he doesn't know why he's going there, but somehow I've got to get him from the house to that crime scene, and that's all. And it has to fit those parameters. And it might be 400 words. It might be 500 words. That's all. And then tomorrow it's 500 more, and it adds up. Steinbeck talked about that. And Hemingway had his quota for any given day was 500 words, and letters counted. If he wrote a letter to one of his ex-wives, that counted.
Oh, okay. Answering emails is perfectly fine.
Yeah, exactly. We could.
Grocery list.
That's what you do. You just break it down.
Okay. And I imagine during that session, if you want to call it that, where you've got, well, I've got my 500 words, I've got to get this guy to the location, whatever that assignment is you've given yourself. During the course of that, you may write it, correct it, kind of edit it a little bit on the fly, sure. And then maybe read it again, and then go, okay, I think that's about what the scene should be.
Sure. And every writer is different. A lot of writers subscribe to this idea that you just vomit it all out in one shitty draft, is what they call it.
Right, right. Yeah.
One dirty draft, let's say that. And then you'll go back when you're done and edit. I'm a newspaper man. In my career as a newspaper writer, I had a deadline every single day. The story I'm writing right now is going to be in tomorrow morning's newspaper.
Mm.
At any given moment during the writing of this story, an editor come along and say, hey, Ron, I need you to run up to the city hall real quick, or there's a fire out. So you learn to kind of make your first draft at least publishable.
I guess.
Because you might not get that second draft.
Yeah, you've had a lot of practice in being quickly articulate and concise.
Yeah, right. And so I do a lot of what I guess I'd call this kind of rolling editing, where I do that segment and it's pretty good. And I get on to the next segment, but then I might reread that one to make sure they fit together. And pretty soon you're just kind of rolling forward with multiple things. But the bottom line, I do better first drafts because of my newspaper experience. I don't subscribe to that just make something ugly and then go back and polish it a little bit. Yeah.
That's interesting. You and I have that in common because I have an improv background in theater and voices and stuff. So often I've learned that the first impulse, the first reflection or idea has a lot of potency. It doesn't necessarily get better if I polish it. It just gets different. So, you know, with that as a kind of, you know, I've drilled it and performed it and performed it. And it's like, it's pretty hard to go back and do anything any other way. So it sounds like that's a similar kind of facility.
Similar. And I don't want to make it sound like I get to the end of that one big long first draft and never look at it again. That would be wrong. But yeah.
I narrated a book by, you know, Richard Brautigan.
Sure. So
Trout Fishing in America. And I narrated a book by him, and I was excited about it because I remember Trout Fishing in America, and I remember a Confederate general in Big Sur. That was another book he wrote. And they said, yeah, we got this book. It's never been published before. His family didn't allow it to be, but we're publishing it now. And it was a kind of an experiment where I think he got like one of those moleskin books, and he just started to write the novel, and he didn't go back. And his rule to himself was, I'm not going to go back and look at the pages. And he went all the way to the end of the book, and it was a pretty crappy book to say. It was very disappointing.
And those experimental kinds of writing routines can be extraordinary or they can be really bad. I mean, we all believe that Jack Kerouac, you know, typed on a continuous roll, right, which he did.
Right.
That doesn't mean he didn't edit a little bit. But that stream of consciousness comes through. And of course, he defined the writing style of the Beat period. And it was extraordinary. Brautigan was equally extraordinary. It's just that in some of his experiments, you know, they were experiments. You don't have a roadmap.
And maybe he never intended it to be published. We got this from Tank Ferret, who I don't know. He said, I know that comics are often scoffed at by prose writers. And I'm not sure if he means like comic books or comic writer or comic comedians, but we have to detail as much story in a little space. Oh, maybe that's like a cartoon panel without rushing the plot, so to speak. I feel this personally.
And pacing, everything. That's one of the things to me. Your news anchor woman is a storyteller. A poet is a storyteller. An impressionist is a storyteller. A songwriter is a storyteller.
Right.
What about being a news anchor woman makes you a good poet? What about being a great songwriter makes you a good filmmaker or news anchor woman for that matter? There's nothing. Each of these has its own conventions. Each genre, each model has its own conventions. And that was difficult for me going from nonfiction writing, journalistic storytelling and nonfiction storytelling to suddenly now I'm in fiction. I have to go back and kind of re-educate myself and get familiar with those conventions. And frankly, I'm a storytelling junkie. So I loved that process, but I've written three screenplays, none produced. I've written maybe thousands of articles, 19 books. Each one of those takes some special convention that's different than all the rest.
100%. Totally understand. Yeah, it's different. I work on a movie or a multi-camera TV show or an animated film or a soap opera. They're all storytelling. They're completely different languages. Before we go any further, and we're not going to go too much longer, but I do want to let people know that, I want you, Ron, to let us know where we can find your work, where people can purchase your books and your upcoming audiobook of Death Row?
Well, first of all, you can get a good overview of all my work at my website, ronfrancell.com. That's Ron, as you see there on the screen, FRANSCELL.com. And there are tabs in there. You can look at all my books, some of my blog writing, my events. Thank you. And you can get a good overview there. My books are available anywhere you buy books, Amazon, your local bookstore. I'm a big believer in independent bookstores. Keep them alive. Online, you can get them in ebook form, audio book form, especially Death Row, which I'm told is superlative.
Yeah, I believe I told you that. And I'll tell you again. I'll tell a man. Well, it was a fun read and it was a great, great adventure. I want to ask you one last thing, which is, you know, maybe not the greatest marketing ploy in the world, but writers I know are also, generally speaking, big readers. Yeah. And is there anything you're reading these days or you've read recently that tickled you?
I'm going to share something with you that's difficult to share. I am a writer because I was a reader as a youngster and all the way through my career. But for the past 15 years, I haven't read a single book for fun.
Good Lord.
I read a lot of books. I read research. I'm reading some of my colleagues' books. I'm reading a lot of books and reading a lot of very good books. But I have not
read on the clock.
A book for fun in 15 years.
Wow.
And because I've gotten to the point now as a writer where it's like a carpenter walking into a house, a beautiful house. He doesn't see the scope of the beauty in this house. He looks at that little piece of woodwork there and says, how did he do that? And suddenly he fixates on that until he just can't appreciate the house. And so it is with me. I'll be reading a book and I find myself angry or sad or laughing. And I say, how did he do that? So I flip back a few pages to see where this starts.
Yeah.
I want to know how he did it because maybe I want to do that.
Right, right. That's a professional, a professional viewpoint looking at a piece of
art. It is, but it's not fun. So it's difficult for me to pick up a book and just get pure enjoyment out of it and put the writer and editor aside and just enjoy this story. I've read hundreds of books in my life. I've appreciated many of them. Many of them have influenced my writing. But these days, I will read friends' books. I will read books to review, and I read my research, of course. But I you won't find me walking into a bookstore and saying, "Hey," flipping through the pages and saying, "Yeah, I think I'll read this book."
Wow. Well, I'm really glad I asked you that. That's very interesting. I mean, I understand from the point of view of now when I go to a movie or watch a TV show, I'm also watching it as an audience. But also, you know, if it's not a really good story, I stop watching it as an audience. I'm just watching it as an actor or someone involved in filmmaking. And, you know, if it's a real, you know, challenging film, like I won't mention any names, but Babylon. it's hard to just sit there and be an audience member. I start looking at things like, oh, I wonder, is that a LED screen or is that real practical?
Exactly.
Drifting.
And that's exactly what I'm talking about. You just get.
But I still try, you know, and I go to films lately. You know, I found to recommend a film, the great director, Mike Lee. I'm suddenly totally enamored with Mike Lee because I watched this movie called Mr. Turner about JMW Turner, the painter. And he's got a whole different way of making a film. Anyway, I'm not going to go on about it, but I found myself, you know, totally an audience member, yet at the same time going, all right, how the F did he do this? Because it's so rich and so much brilliance in it. You're like, oh my God. And I had to afterwards research and go, well, how does he do it? You know, and look at interviews and stuff like that. Well, I hope that you have a long plane ride or a train ride somewhere and get to read something for pleasure soon.
Well, I probably find a way to say it's not for fun. It's for work or something.
Yeah, I understand. I only like to read books that I'm being paid for. So I totally
there you go.
Well, listen, thank you so much for your time. We had some nice people tell us things. This fella here did, for example, and he gave me some advice. And he also said that. Anyway, those of you who tuned in, I really appreciate it. And please do pick up any of Ron's books that you can. They're terrific. And he's only going to get better. So
Let's hope. Death Row comes out on February 14th, but it's available for pre-order right now. So if you pre-order the audiobook, the downloadable version anyway, and the ebook, and at Amazon or wherever, it'll be delivered to your phone a little after midnight on February 14th, and you'll have it sooner than anybody except Jim.
That's right. I beat you all. You pathetic mortals. All right. Thanks so much, Ron Franscell.
Thank you.
I hope that we get to collaborate again soon someday. And for the rest of you, thank you very much. I'm going to end off here and see you in the movies.
Thank you.